welcome to another episode of Legacy's Allure, brought to you by MTG Training Grounds, the educational series dedicated to providing you with all the info on popular decks, strategies, insight, and more for the Legacy format. I am your host, Zachary Cook. For today's episode, we're going to take a new perspective. Until now, all the episodes featured deck techs of popular Legacy archetypes and guests who were very specialized in those decks. This time, we're going to try and use some of the knowledge we've built and try to identify what decks we're likely playing against and how we should plan our game accordingly. Helping us today is a popular face from the SCG Tour. He has plenty of experience playing a host of different decks in the Legacy format and has some impressive performances to show for it, including 8 Star City Games Open Top 8s, 2 of which resulted in a win. One Grand Prix Top 32, where he finished 13th at the Legacy Grand Prix in Washington, D.C. He has competed in the 2015 Star City Games Players Championship. He's a content writer and video streamer for the MTG Card Market, where he covers a gamut of formats. He has a host of Legacy articles to keep his readers current on shifts in the metagame, and to showcase the latest in new decks, new techs, and emerging trends. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Rudy Briksza. Rudy, welcome to Legacy's Allure.
Hi, Zach. How's it going?
It's going good. I'm excited.
Yeah, I am too.
up until now, we've been doing like deck techs, and we've covered a lot of sort of the most common Legacy decks, like the tier one and some of the like what you might call tier 1.5, or you know the most common decks to show up sort of in the top eights of big tournaments. And now I'd like to put some of that knowledge to use, and we're gonna have like some example scenarios where we look at the play lines of our opponent, try and figure out what it is they're playing with all that knowledge we've been working on building, and then maybe run through those scenarios as though we're playing, you know, specific decks on the opposing side. So I think given how you know the variety of decks you've played.
It's a lot. It's certainly a lot. It's like one of the things that when I first started playing Legacy, I kind of only had access to one deck, so I'd really play just this one strategy over and over and over again, and that was Stoneblade. But as time went on and I started making new friends and I started growing a collection, I started playing a bunch of different decks. So I've played like a gamut of decks, and a lot of people have really kind of known me for like these mid-range decks like Shardless, or sometimes controlling decks like Miracles or even like Stoneblade. Like these are the kind of decks I've known for. It's really funny watching people who know me sit across from me and they're like, all right, at least I don't have to play against a combo deck, and I'll just be like, all right, Gitaxian Probe, Dark Ritual, Lotus Petal, and then they're just like, oh my god.
No. All right. Well, that's good, because most of my experience has been with like Delver style decks and Infect, mostly aggressive stuff. So between your experience with the control-y sort of mid-range decks and mine doing aggressive decks, I hope we can get a pretty good look at these examples. Now, we're not really assessing combo decks very much because they don't typically play with their opponent as much. Now, obviously, some of them do like Storm. You're going to have Duress and Cabal Therapy and stuff, but for the most part, you sort of do your own thing, and it's your opponent who's trying to catch up and stop you. So, well, like I said, we'll focus on the more interactive strategies. So anyway, here's how this is going to work. We're going to present a scenario. I'll describe what's going on. Then Rudy and I will discuss what inferences we can make based on the play we see from our imaginary opponent. And then we'll discuss like what the important cards are, what our line of play should be, and the different decisions we'll have to make from the perspective of different decks. So Rudy, you can cover Shardless, Soul Tie, and Miracles, and I'll take Death and Taxes and Infect.
So I think those are a lot of good, relatively interactive decks. Maybe not with Infect as much, but Infect's kind of like that weird combo deck where it's not exactly a combo deck per se, but it's also, you know, just has like all this different interaction and has to like use the combat step to win.
All right, so let's get into it now. Example one. Now for both, one more caveat here. For all of these, we're gonna look at it as though we're both on the play and the draw. Although in most of the cases, it will be more important, I think, if we are on the draw to be able to assess it really quickly, because that you're already at sort of a disadvantage in most Legacy matches if you're on the draw. So it's even more important to be able to evaluate these quickly. So anyway, The example scenario one, our opponent has not mulliganed, and they lead with a hand, or they lead with Mountain, Suspend Rift Bolt. Now this one seems pretty obvious, Rudy. What are your thoughts?
I don't know, probably Storm, Show and Tell. Actually, as you said, this one's kind of the more obvious one. Rift Bolt is only played in one deck in Legacy, as far as I know, or at least one deck that's played a lot, and that's going to be Burn in this scenario. Mm-hmm.
So from Shardless Soul Tell, let's start there. First of all, I agree. I think this is 100% Burn. And our play, and Burn is one of those kind of matchups where depending on what deck you're on, your play pattern will very specifically shift one direction or the other. So starting with Shardless Soul Tie, what are the most important cards for you in this matchup? And what is your general line of play going to push you towards? Like what kind of moves do you need to make? How do you need to utilize your spells and your fetch lands and so on?
Well, for this, if I'm playing Shardless, there are three cards that I'm really looking for in the early game against Burn. And the three cards that I really want are Deathrite Shaman, Tarmogoyf, and Hymn to Torak. And the reason you want Deathrite is it kind of allows you to get ahead on mana, which is going to be really important. Burn's an incredibly mana-efficient deck. They play sometimes between 18 and 20 lands, rarely more than that. So, and everything they have costs generally one or two. So it's really important to try and keep pace with them. So Deathrite Shaman is really important with that. Deathrite Shaman also has the ability to gain you life, which, you know, I mean, even though technically Burn only needs seven spells, since almost all of their spells do three damage. Mm-hmm. So they only need seven spells. So Deathrite Shaman can sometimes give you a couple extra turns. One of the reasons I want Tarmogoyf is Tarmogoyf is always going to be really big. So it's going to be good for blocking Goblin Guide, blocking Monastery Swift Spear, blocking Eidolon of the Great Revel. And it's also really good because it's generally going to be a 3 to a 5 power creature. It's going to be really good at attacking. So sometimes you just kind of need to race, and Tarmogoyf is really good at helping you swing everything in your favor. The last card that I really want is Hymn to Torak. Hymn to Torak is going to be really good in this matchup since they play so few lands and so many spells that Hymn is normally going to hit a couple spells. And since they don't really have a way to, you know, set their deck up or a way to draw extra cards, they're really relying on the top of their deck here. And since most of their deck is kind of the same card over and over again, just a Hymn to Torak can give you, you know, two extra turns.
Mm-hmm. I agree. I think Hymn to Torak is probably the most important card in the first like 2 to 3 turns of the game, just because their hand, they can't empty it fast enough. So you're, like you said, you're almost certainly going to hit one or two spells, and that effectively neuters lines of play they had and takes away, you know, it's essentially like two black, gain 6 life or more. So that's a really efficient deal against a deck like Burn. I think the only other thing worth noting with Shardless is that you have usually two basics, right? One forest and one swamp.
Right. I'd say on average, you're almost guaranteed to play against a Shardless player who has one basic swamp in their deck, but I think the forest is becoming a lot more popular, and especially with four color loam getting really popular and lands being a popular deck, I think most Shardless decks are kind of moving to the double basic just to always have something against the Wasteland decks.
Yeah. And the reason that's important is one of the most common big damage spells out of Burn is Price of Progress, and because Shardless is usually a little slower to win, preserving any extra life total or life points you can could be huge. So avoiding the non-basics as much as reasonably possible would be important. So I'll take one here now and say, let's look at it from Death and Taxes perspective. Well, first of all, this is a terrible matchup. If we don't have a hand, and assuming we're on the draw, this is really, really bad. If we're on the play and we happen to open up with an Aether Vial, we maybe have a shot because we can keep pace and hopefully get into a Stoneforge Mystic Batterskull scenario where we can like start gaining life back. Otherwise, we're incredibly slow to win a game. We have no form of interaction with regards to their spells. We can potentially deal with their creatures to some degree with things like Thalia being able to, you know, with First Strike being able to block their creatures, or Flicker Wisp being able to, you know, to interact with their creatures. But other than that, our normal defenses are pretty weak. And like I said, the most important or the key to this whole matchup will be finding a Stoneforge Mist to get us one of the two, either Batterskull, which is probably the better one, or Mizzaz Jitte to start gaining life back. Because if it goes to like turn four or five and we haven't got a life gain engine online, I don't think there's much chance that we could win this match. So it's really just a race to a piece of equipment. So Rudy, what about miracles?
If I'm playing miracles, the card that I'm looking for the most, or I guess the two cards I'm looking for the most, are Sensei's Divining Top and Counterbalance. And that's kind of more of an obvious line of play. Since Miracles is generally a slow to kill deck, and Treat's kind of slow, Jace is really slow, Snapcaster's like a 10 turn clock, Click is, you know, a 7 turn clock. This is not really great, even if you have, you know, Venser to like bounce a spell and gain you some tempo. It's still not great. I know some Miracles decks are trying to, maybe have a faster clock with Nahiri and Emrakul, but even so, you know, Nahiri's a 4, you know, converted mana cost card. It's going to take you a little while to get that engine going, and 15 damage from Emrakul is not necessarily going to kill them. So top and counterbalance are really what you're looking for. They're really your way to leverage everything. Obviously, cards that are kind of hard for you to beat as miracles are if they have an early creature. Eidolon's going to be pretty tough, so Swords of Plowshares are generally good. Terminus is going to be great, since you don't have to take any damage, but Rip Bolt's going to be tough for you to beat. Fire Blast is going to be tough to beat, because with counterbalance, you really don't have a lot of threes and sixes, since those are kind of slim. So those are kind of the cards you're hoping to avoid, in the late game.
Yeah, I agree. That matchup's tough without an early counterbalance. That's really the linchpin of that whole match is going to be getting a counterbalance in the first couple turns. And then, like you said, finding the top to go with it, because counterbalance is okay on its own, but it really needs the control, the manipulation to lock the game out.
Right, and especially since a lot of the Miracles decks have kind of moved away from, you know, early interaction like Spell Pierce, and they're more on the Force of Will, maybe 1-2 counterspell plan, it's not really going to be that easy to find some form of interaction against them early.
Okay, and then finally with Infect, this is actually a really good matchup, and if they're opening up on Suspended Rift Bolt, that actually implies to me that they have a pretty weak hand, because they would almost always want to start with a creature if they had one. So if they're suspending Rift Bolt, then I feel like I'm firmly in the driver's seat, and the ideal line is to open up on a Hierarch, Noble Hierarch, because they don't want to Rift Bolt that, but it gives you extra mana and extra, options in the following turns. The only thing you have to be worried about, I think, is that if they kept this hand on the strength of maybe like a pair of Eidolons or something like that, that they're planning to throw out the next couple turns, that could be problematic, and that could be problematic for any of these decks we're talking about. But like I said, otherwise, I think this is kind of a weak hand, and with Infect, almost all of your hands are going to be pretty solid. You just want an early creature with some pump spells. They're not likely to have much in the way of interaction. They've already basically announced they don't have a good blocker. So this is very favorable, and actually the way you'd like it to be. You'd like them to open on the Rift Bolt. Anyway, let's look at scenario two then. Our opponent has not mulliganed. They open on a Wooded Foothills, which they then use to search up a Bayou and play a Deathrite Shaman. Now, this can be a few different decks, but we have our thoughts on which one is probably the most likely. So, Rudy, I'll let you start.
So, this is a really common line that you see out of Elves. Elves, generally, they exclusively play green fetches. Doesn't really matter what you see, but generally a green fetch into a Bayou for a Deathrite Shaman is pretty typical. Elves is a deck that really wants to have a lot of mana as early as possible. So typical turn one plays are Green Sun Zenith for zero for a Dryad Arbor, play a Deathrite Shaman, or sometimes they could theoretically play a Heritage Druid to untap, play two more Elves, and start making a ton of mana. So my initial guess would be Elves. But I also wouldn't be that surprised to see my opponent cast a Dark Confidant or Liliana the Veil next turn, as this is also pretty common play for Jund as well.
Yeah, I think the only discerning thing there, or the thing that's most likely to make this Elves, is that Elves is a more commonly played deck. Otherwise,
right.
it's really impossible to tell.
Right, anyway. But I think either way, you're kind of wanting a similar hand. Although these decks are intrinsically very different, Jund and Elves, you kind of want a similar hand against them. If you're playing a deck like Shardless, what you really want is a bunch of early removal. and interaction cards. Like Thought Seize are going to be pretty good. Abrupt Decay is going to be really good, being able to take care of Deathrite, Confidant, Liliana the Veil, Heritage Druid, Wirewood Symbiote. The list of creatures that Abrupt Decay takes care of is going to be good. Thought Seize is going to be good at, you know, being able to be proactive and nab something like a Green Sun Zenith or a Natural Order, or if they're playing Jund, perhaps a removal spell, Sylvan Library. So those are going to be cards that you're really going to want as well. And then the other card you're going to kind of want a Shardless is Tarmogoyf in either of these matchups. Tarmogoyf's just going to be really good at attacking through and is going to put both decks on a quick clock.
Yeah, I think the only real, like you said, the hands are going to be, you want similar things. The only real difference, I would think, between Jund, if this is Jund versus Elves, is you do not want to see a Force of Will in your Shardless opener against Jund, because they're almost certainly going to take it away from you. If it's Elves, it would actually be, it seems like it would be really good to have, because if they go into a really quick Natural Order, you could actually just die before you get set up. So,
right.
It's hard to say you want, but...
Yeah. I will say this, since your opponent is playing, if you assume for a second, we're wrong, our opponent's playing Jund for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. This is actually a turn where I actually would appreciate Force of Will in the early turns, because with the Deathrite Shaman, that's going to give them a ton of more mana on you, especially since they're on the play here. Right. And a turn two Liliana the Veil might be really difficult to beat. And close to impossible in some cases. So in this case, I wouldn't actually mind an early Force of Will, but when you get to the mid game, that's when Force of Will is starting to get really weak. But I think in the early games, when your opponent's ahead, and especially ahead with the Deathrite, that Force of Will might be reasonable.
Okay, good call. All right, so I'll take Death and Taxes. Once again, this is terrible. It doesn't matter if this is Jund or Death and or Elves. Either one of them opening on the elf into a potential turn two, either turn two elf combo or turn two Liliana can just be just about lights out for Death and Taxes. I guess we'd prefer it was Jund, just because some of our other tools like Moran Crusader and Phyrexian Revoker can be somewhat useful. But in general, this is just, we're going to get slaughtered, and let's move to the sideboard.
Yeah, certainly. I think either way, you're like hoping that your opening hand is turn one Swords to Plowshares, yeah. Turn two like Thalia, just or Stoneforge Mystic, just something.
Yeah. How about Miracles?
Oh, for Miracles, Elves is really a tough matchup because they can kind of play two games where they can just put a couple creatures out here and just kind of attack you and drain you for a couple life every turn. And you know, even though it seems kind of slow, it is going to be like a 6-turn clock, a 5-turn clock. So it's going to be something that's going to be kind of difficult for you to manage. And you're going to really need a Terminus early. The other thing is if Elves can also just play this combo game where they're just like, all right, well, I'm just going to combo you out as quick as possible. Do you have a Terminus? Okay, that's fine. We can keep playing. You don't? Okay, you're dead. So counterbalance, obviously going to be really good in this scenario, just because it's going to be good at trying to counter. Elves is filled with one drops. But I think Terminus is going to be really important, as is potentially a well-timed Swords of Plowshares or Snapcaster Mage.
Right. And I think if it's Jund, then unfortunately you're looking for a lot of the other pieces. Counterbalance is going to be really bad, because that's basically the only target they have for their Abrupt Decays. And you're going to want tons of plows and stuff, because every single Dark Confidant and Tarmogoyf becomes a massive problem.
Right. Yeah, the best cards for against Jund is going to be Swords to Plowshares, going to be Terminus, Snapcaster Mage, and Jace. These are going to be the cards. Terminus is pretty low on that list, but like Snapcaster, Swords to Plowshares, and Jace the Mind Sculptor, those really are what we're going to want to see early. Sensei's Divining Top, I mean, is obviously a linchpin of the deck. Can't really you can function without it, but it's certainly a lot harder, and getting to look at the top of your deck and rearrange means you can kind of find different answers that you need at different points in time, which is going to be really helpful.
Yeah, I guess we should probably just make that caveat right up front here before we get into any more examples. Any hand with Sensei's Top is just a better one for Miracles. So that's always what you want. Now, but we'll look at the what do you want in addition to the top?
Right.
All right, and for Infect, this is another really solid matchup. Barring a quick combo kill, they are a noticeably slower clock than Infect on average. You have cantrips to find the combo pieces. They have virtually no way to interact with it. They don't even have good blockers, because half of your creatures have flying or are unblockable. So basically game one, when they have no interaction, your priority is get an Ink Moth or a Blighted Agent down and combo kill them as soon as you're ready because they can't stop it. The only thing you might need to find or work to have is a Force of Will in case they have a quick natural order kill. Otherwise, I think you're sitting pretty here. All right, so let's look at example number three. Now, our opponent has mulliganed to six and decided to keep. Their opening play is a Mox Diamond. After it resolves, of course, they're going to have to discard a land. So we'll say we let it resolve. They discard a Verdant Catacombs. They play a Bayou. And then with the two mana from the Bayou and the Mox Diamond, they play a Life from the Loam, targeting their Verdant Catacombs. And we'll assume that that resolves because it's I can't imagine many scenarios where you'd want to Force a Will, a turn one Life from the Loam on just a fetch land. So we now know that they have a Verdant Catacombs in hand, along with, I guess that would be 1, 2, 3, 4, two other cards, and the Life from the Loam is in their graveyard. So, Rudy, what do you think this is?
So, I think this one is actually probably one of the hardest ones to figure out on our list, because there's really only two decks that I can think of that it could be, but that doesn't mean like the range of this kind of strategy isn't large. Mm-hmm. So my first thought would be it's going to be a Dark Lands build. I know if people really aren't familiar with this, basically people took the green red lands, they kind of cut out Grove of the Burn Willows and added Abrupt Decay and Molten Vortex in the main deck, and then sideboard they're going to have cards like Dark Confidant and Thoughtseize. But if somebody does Mox Diamond for Verdant Catacombs, Bayou Life of the Loam, I'm probably going to put them on lands. That's really a play that lands wants to make as early as possible. You know, they have an Accelerant, which is going to be really good, and they have a Loam, so they're going to get to start their engine quick, and they're already ahead of the game because they have a Mox Diamond. The other deck that I was thinking about is a four-color Loam, which is kind of like the... even though... if you look at results from like the Bazaar of Moxen for the last few years, or like a lot of the European GPs, four color Loam is everywhere. But for America, it's kind of been this new kid on the block, and it's been getting really popular lately. But I'm less likely to think it's that deck because Life from the Loam is kind of in their deck is, you know, a good way to get Knight of the Reliquary bigger, or way to kind of fix their Sylvan Libraries, but it's not really something that they want to lead off with. So I'm a lot more hesitant to think it's four color Loam, and a lot more likely to think it's lands.
Yeah, I agree. It's either that, like you said, it's either the new version of lands that's running the black spells, mostly Abrupt Decay, and then the sideboard Dark Confidants, or like you said, it could be the aggro Loam or four color Loam. Really, the indicator will be on turn two. If they dredge Loam, you got to watch what lands hit. Like, if you see anything that produces white, like a scab land or a fetch land that smells funny. Like, basically, if it's a fetch land that isn't green, then like right. If you see a Marsh Flats, that's a dead giveaway.
Yeah, Bloodstained Mire, yeah. Badlands, like those kind of things. I mean, obviously, if you see a creature, but if they just mill over three randoms and right. You can't really tell, that's a good indicator.
The thing is, or the thing worth really noting here is both of those decks function very similarly. They both try to establish a wasteland lock via their Life from the Loam. One of them does it with, the Mox Diamond Accelerant into things like, it's called Exploration, and things like that. That's lands. And the other one will try and rush out a Knight of the Reliquary or something, or like a Liliana, something that can put pressure while they look for their wastelands and stuff. And both of them, though, are going to like drag the game out, make a huge threat, and try and destroy all your lands or keep your resources super limited. So that in mind, what is Shardless going to do in this scenario?
If I'm Shardless and my opponent leads off with a Mox Diamond, I'm really going to hope that there's a Deathrite Shaman in my opener. Deathrite Shaman, besides its obvious aspects of being able to exile a ton of lands and being able to kind of manage that, it's also a good way for you to keep up with their accelerants. Just Mox Diamond in general just really lets them skip ahead a turn, and Deathrite Shaman is your way to kind of, you know, keep pace with them just because they have a Mox Diamond. It also has the added benefit of, you know, eating a ton of their lands or ripping out their Life from the Loam from underneath them. So it's certainly a card I'm going to look for. In either way, The card that I'm looking for a lot is Jace the Mind Sculptor. Jace the Mind Sculptor is going to be good in both of these matchups if it's lands. Jace is going to be really good at, you know, being able to close out the game. Punishing Fire can be really slow, and if you have a Deathrite Shaman, you can manage it. And if they have Molten Vortex, you can Abrupt Decay Molten Vortex, you know, before they kill your Jace. But Jace is going to be a good way to kill their game. If they're four-color Loam, Jace is also going to be really good since it's going to be able to help you recoup a lot of the losses. They have cards like Dark Confidant and Sylvan Library, which are going to be really good at gaining them a lot of card advantage and helping them get out much farther ahead than you are. Even though you have Ancestral Vision in your deck, Ancestral Vision can sometimes be a little slow. So you want Jace to kind of, you know, set up your draws, clean up what you have in your hand, and make sure you have a way to really fight through everything that they have.
Yeah, I think that's definitely Jace is one of the key pieces. And unlike the last two matchups, a card like Hymn to Torak is actually probably not what you want as much of here, because it's so easy for them to recoup the card advantage. Like, your 2-for-1 can quickly turn right back into a 1-for-0 after they loam a few times and
right.
Sort of take that away from you. For Death and Taxes, I think this matchup could be up in the air. It depends what the rest of their hand is like. You personally, you want to have probably an early Mother of Runes to keep your other pieces protected, and then just all of the typical control pieces. You'll want Phyrexian Revoker maybe to shut down some of their activated abilities like Knight of the Reliquary or even their Mox Diamond. You probably want Thalia to help slow down some of their non-creature spells. Because even though they have this fast Mox Diamond, you can actually still put pressure on their mana and then their flow of mana if you have the right hand for it. And then the key piece is Batterskull, I think. Once you have sort of an early setup to protect yourself, they have a hard time dealing with a Batterskull. So if you can get a Stoneforge down, tutor up the equipment, and keep the Stoneforge alive for a turn, I think that Batterskull can probably go most of the distance on its own.
Yeah. I can definitely see that happening.
I'm not saying it'll be easy, but it's you know,
yeah,
that's your line. So what about Miracles?
For Miracles, if this is the lands and this is the Dark Lands version, you're really hoping that their first dredge is 2 Abrupt Decay. Abrupt Decay. Counterbalance is one of your best cards against just Life in the Loam in general. It's going to prevent them from kind of gaining any advantage by being able to play multiple lands in a turn, or by being able to, you know, present a Merit Lage over and over again. It's, you know, that's really one of the ways that lands beats Miracles, is just by, you know, making a copy of Dark Depths and, you know, attacking for 20. You're like, oh, Plower Terminus, okay, Life in the Loam, play another stage, play another Depths, make another 20/20, and just keep going through the cycle until your opponent misses or they die. So a counterbalance is going to prevent them from really recasting Loam over and over and over again. If it's the Abrupt Decay version, you're going to try to want to find multiple copies of Counterbalance. So even though I like the first copy Counterbalance, the second I see that this is lands, I'm immediately going to start looking for a second one. I'm also going to want to have a Swords to Plowshares in your hand, because lands has this really interesting aspect to it that it can just draw cards and play their lands, play one land a turn, and then they'll just Rish and import you out of the game and just make a Merit Lage and try to tap you out all your white sources. So it's important to try to keep some fetch lands up as much as possible. So I'm going to want like 2 fetch lands, 2 counterbalances, and a plow in my hand to try and take control of the game. Once I have control of the game and I have a ton of lands, I'm looking for an Entreat the Angels specifically, because I want to end this match as fast as possible. I don't want to give them any time to really work their way back into it or draw a bunch. Jace is also acceptable, although Jace is obviously a little bit slower. And sometimes you got to spend some time brainstorming to kind of set up your counterbalance or find another one just to protect yourself. So I'm really looking for a quick Entreat, you know, for 4 or 5 even, to just end the game in a turn or two.
Yeah. And finally, with Infect, if this is lands, the most important card of the whole matchup is going to be Vines of Vastwood, because they're almost certainly going to try and get a Maze of If going quickly, because that's like sort of their best defense against your creatures, and Vines nullifies all of their defenses. The other thing is Noble Hierarch. You want to like Rudy alluded to earlier with Deathrite Shaman, you want to catch up on mana. Infect's a super mana efficient deck. Cards like Invigorate and Force of Will can help you catch up tempo wise, but long term they'll just have more resources than you. So you really have to get an early threat, get the Vines to sort of ensure it can get through, and then go for as quick a combo kill as you can, because you just you cannot win a long game against a deck like this. Same thing is true if this is aggro loam or four color loam. They'll eventually have Wastelands and Punishing Fires going, but those things take a little bit of time. They take some mana and resources, so you just try and squeeze in a combo kill as quick as you can, and hope that they don't have like a super, super fast hand. And that's actually, while we're talking about this here with the quick combo kill, that's one of the reasons I chose to do Infect as opposed to a Delver deck, because most Delver decks in this scenario, there is no such thing as a fast kill. Like, their best hope is like for maybe five turns if they can play a turn one Delver and keep it alive. And I think waiting five turns to try and kill lands or loam or the loam deck is just disastrous. She'll just get obliterated with Delver Secrets here. So anyway, I think that covers that scenario pretty well. Any other thoughts, Rudy?
I think that kind of covers most of it. I do agree. I like your analysis for Vines of Asswood being super important. It's just when I was playing lands, that was just the card that I never wanted them to have.
And out of the sideboard, you want Teferi's Response, because that'll ruin their guarantee.
I heard it ruined Jim Davis's day once.
It did one time. All right. So, scenario four. This one we're going to only look at as though we're on the draw, and there's a reason I've chosen that. So anyway, our opponent has not mulliganed. They lead on a wooded foothills and pass the turn. No plays. So it is our turn, first turn, and we're on the draw. Rudy, what do you think this is?
I've been thinking about this for a while, and because this one was really interesting. I actually have narrowed it down. I actually think I figured it out. I think it's Rug Delver.
I do too.
And I think I've been thinking about this for a while, because I thought this one was really important. I originally, when you like sent me all of this, I just was like, yeah, I don't know, for like four, just like rattled off every other one that I thought about. But I didn't think that was like a reasonable thing. So I took some time and I thought about it, and I thought, what is most likely for a deck that goes Wooded Foothills Pass? And I think it's Rug Delver. I think there are some other decks, but I think it's Rug Delver, because the deck that doesn't have a turn one play and plays a Wooded Foothills might be masquerading, but it's a blue deck and it probably has Stifle. So what I'm going to do with Shardless is I'm going to hope that I have a Deathrite Shaman in my hand, a Tarmogoyf in my hand, and an Abrupt Decay. These are the cards that I'm looking for. But mostly, I'm just going to look for a bunch of lands and just go land pass for a little while and try and play a controlling game, because a deck like Rug Delver is generally going to be unfavored in a matchup against Shardless. And you're just going to want to, as long as you're making your land drops and taking everything in stride, you're generally going to win a long game.
Yeah, I agree. I think this is... this is most likely the team or a Rug Delver. And the reason being, if they did not mulligan and their opening play is just land pass. Now we're playing Legacy, where it is defined by its one mana plays, or like the necessity of velocity. Like, you have to get out fast. And like almost every deck in the format has one mana spells, either cheap creatures or cantrips. And every deck is going to play one of those or discard, like something like a Thoughtseize. And if our opponent felt that their hand was worth keeping but had no one mana plays, or you know, theoretically no one mana plays, I think they're bluffing. Like, they have a one mana play and they're waiting for us to walk into it. So I completely agree. I think this is Rug Delver, and I think the most important thing we cannot do is crack a fetch land.
Right.
We do not want to under any circumstances. Now that said, if I'm on Death and Taxes, I'm just gonna play a Plains and whatever the heck spell I can, because go ahead and let them daze it if they want. Like, that's not a big deal. We're just making parity, and actually they're the one behind on land then. So that's completely fine. So if you're on Death and Taxes, just any turn one play you have, jam it. It doesn't matter. And you would ideally like to lead on a Plains if you have it, or something like a Flagstones of Trochee, or something that they can't wasteland. But if you don't have that choice, like if you have to lead on a Thespian Stage into an Aether Vial, you know, so be it. Or, I mean, not this. Rashadenport, that's what I mean. Rashadenport into Aether Vial, that's fine too. If they want to spend their second turn wasting you and being at zero, or you know, zero permanence, zero permanence, that's completely acceptable. How about Miracles?
So if I'm Miracles, now I don't know if people are going to necessarily agree with this, but I'm actually just going to turn one pass as well. I'm just going to play a land and pass. I'm scared of Daze, but more so I'm scared of Spell Pierce. And one of the best ways, you can actually lock Rogue Delver out with Countertop. They actually have no real way to beat that. So since Countertop is so important, I'm just going to play certainly a control game. Miracles plays really well at playing this control game, but I'm also not going to play any of my, you know, lock pieces until I can either protect them or I can make sure that I'm, you know, I have another one and I can afford to play around the kind of removal or anything that they have, any interaction that they have, like Spell Pierce or Daze.
Yeah, and that's actually a pretty good point you make there, Rudy, that Miracles does play a good control game. And actually, in this scenario, there's no reason for any of these decks to get too ambitious. Like, there is no pressure from our opponent. And if they are truly Rug Delver, like we think, they have to spill the beans before we are in any trouble. Like, we'll know when they play a Delver Secrets or a Nimble Mongoose or a Tarmogoyf or something. We'll know that the jig is up and that's exactly what we're playing against. So there's no reason for us to rush into like forcing out a Sensei's Top into a potential Daze or a Spell Pierce, like you said. Like, even not even something like a Ponder, it's not worth running into a Spell Pierce because like we're just not under any pressure and there's no reason to get caught in that trap if they're not forcing us to do it.
I think something else important is just like with Ponder, same with Brainstorm, there's no reason for us to play our draw spells in this case, because even though we've kind of narrowed it down to what most likely the situation is and that it's Rug Delver or Teemer Delver, there's no you don't know exactly what you need in this spot. You don't know if you're going to need that Terminus now or you might need it later. Nimble Mongoose, obviously very difficult to sort to Plowshares, sometimes very difficult to block with anything. So, you know, you're not 100% sure what you need. So I think it's best just to kind of wait.
And finally, with Infect, I would also play just fetch land and leave it uncracked and pass. The only different line I would consider is if I have one of my mana producing lands, like a Tropical Island or a Forest, in my opener, along with either a Glistener Elf or Noble Hierarch, I would actually in this situation consider playing that land and then casting the one mana creature. Because again, if they're going to play a Daze into this, that's fine. Like that actually puts you ahead on mana. And this is a tempo war. Like, it's going to be your tempo versus theirs, and whoever can get further ahead on that is more likely to win. So that's the only scenario where I would play a spell with Infect. Otherwise, yeah, I would do the same thing. Just play a fetch land and pass. Make them blink first if you can.
Right.
All right, so let's go to the fifth scenario here. Our opponent has Mulligan to six. They lead and end cap. They lead off on a Gitaxian Probe, so they know what's in our hand. Now, we don't, because this is a hypothetical scenario, but anyway, they do. They draw off their probe, play a Bloodstained Mire, break it, fetch up an Underground Sea, and cast a Ponder, which we allow to resolve. They choose to shuffle, so obviously whatever they were looking for wasn't in the top three cards. They draw their card and pass the turn. Rudy, what do you think we're playing?
I'm going to have to say that I'm going to have to reach into my bag and pull out a Caleb Scherer token and hand it to my opponent. Thinking about it, like, it could theoretically be Grixis Delver, but because of the Bloodstained Mire, I'm going to guess that it's more likely to be Storm. I mean, it's kind of like this weird thing. Even though Bloodstained Mire works almost perfectly in the Grixis Delver deck, there's one important land that it doesn't fetch, and that's the Tropical Island. Now, I know a lot of people are more than willing to kind of accept that they're just not going to fetch it with that Bloodstained Mire or whatever, or maybe they just can't afford a different fetch and, you know, just own Bloodstained Mire, so there's no reason not to play it. More likely to think that this is Storm because a Swamp is incredibly important for the deck, and Bloodstained Mire does fetch a Swamp. If you look at all their fetch lands, it's generally Bloodstained Mires and Polluted Deltas and then some Scalding Tarns, mostly because that Swamp is so important and so vital to the deck. So the fact that they probed, fetched, and then like shuffled, it depends on their tank. If a person ponders and like tanks, and then shuffles, I'm more likely to think that they're Storm. But if they look at their like top three and shuffle almost immediately, I think that they're still probably Storm, but it's also likely that they're Delver because they just like, obviously there's no threats, no lands, no reason to keep.
Right. And I agree with that assessment. I think I think the real key here is the Bloodstained Mire, like you said. A lot of Storm decks they have a pretty even split, or it might slightly favor Islands, but they want to be able to fetch their basics. And the key is that a deck like Grixis Delver, all of their lands are Islands, in addition to whatever types. They have Underground Seas, Volcanics, and Tropical Islands. So all of their fetch lands should get Islands, even to the extent of playing things like Flooded Strand or whatever in their deck, because it gets the lands they want, and Bloodstained Mire wouldn't be able to get all of them anyway. So yeah, I agree. I think this is Storm, and actually there's a decent chance that if it has Bloodstained Mires and is pushing a little harder on the black mana, this could be a faster version of something like the Epic Storm as opposed to Ad Nauseam. Now that's kind of wishy-washy. Like it could very easily just be Ant as well, but right. I know players who follow Bryant Cook and want to play the Epic Storm are more likely to have the Bloodstained Mires in their deck. So for what that's worth.
Right. So, I mean, so either way, you're assuming that your opponent is on some sort of, you know, combo storm strategy, whether or not they're the more resilient Ad Nauseam Tendrils, or they're the faster Empty the Warrens Epic Storm version. Right. Either way, if you're playing Shardless, you're going to want a couple cards. You're going to want Thoughtseize.
Yes.
You're going to want him to Torok.
Definitely.
you're going to want Force of Will, and you're going to want Tarmogoyf.
Yeah.
these are going to be the cards you want. Tarmogoyf is going to hit them really hard, really quick, so they don't have time to rebuild. Thoughtseize and him to Torok are going to be really good at keeping them back, keeping them down. So, you know, it's going to be a lot harder for them. As we know, Storm needs a high density of spells generally in order to go off, although if they're playing TES, they're... a simple, you know, Cabal Ritual or Dark Ritual, Rite of Flame, Ad Nauseam is, you know, generally enough to kill you as well. Right. So you're going to really want these discard spells, but also Force of Will to back it up.
Yeah, and like you said, the really important piece there is it doesn't matter how many Hymn to Torax or Thoughtseize you have, you don't have the Tarmogoyf or some other really hard, or like strong piece of pressure to go with it. They just have a lot of time to rebuild. So that Goyf is pivotal. If you're on Death and Taxes, you need a Thalia. And you need to start praying, because they can really consistently get you turn two. And if we're on the draw, we're going to be in a lot of trouble. So we have to hope that they can't turn to us. Like, they get stuck playing a lot of Ponders and trying to set their hand up. And we have got to get a Thalia, because nothing else in game one is going to keep us alive other than that. And then even once we have the Thalia, that's not a guarantee. What we'd really like to back it up after that is Rashadnport and Wasteland, to try and keep their mana denied. They've already fetched an underground, so we know we can strip one of their lands. And actually, it's worth noting, it may be correct to just Wasteland, hit them, and pass turn if that's your only line, or if the Thalia is likely to be too slow. But this is going to be a tough match if we're on the draw. If we were on the play, I'd be a little more confident with the Thalia, but in general, this one's bad.
Yeah.
About miracles.
with miracles, you're certainly going to want to counterbalance, although counterbalance is realistically unable to, for the most part, counter something like Tendrils or Past in Flames without a Jace. Their entire deck is filled with ones, twos, and zeros, and something as simple as a land and a Ponder on top of your library can cold them out of casting really anything. I also think it's important, if you're playing miracles in game one, to try and keep any Force of Wills or keep one Force of Will in your hand, but if you ever draw a second one, to keep it on top of your library with Sensei's Divining Top. This is actually incredibly important, and I don't think a lot of people kind of, you know, put that together. They're like, oh well, I really need this Force of Will in my hand. If I don't have this Force of Will in my hand, then I can't cast it. But if you keep it on top of your deck with Sensei's Divining Top, you can protect it from any Cabal Therapies, any Duresses. So as long as you always have a blue card in your hand and a Force Wall on top of your library, you'll always have an answer. A lot of times, Storm, you know, especially Ad Nauseam Tendrils, works on this exact front. Like, they have these exact set of levels, these exact set of spells that they're going to cast, and they get down to it, and they're like, all right, here we go. And you're just like, all right, we'll force that. And then they just have to spend six turns rebuilding, which gives you a lot of time to set up.
Yeah. I mean, I agree. The most important card in this is counterbalance. And if they're a good Storm player, that's going to be probably, I mean, unless they're killing you right away, that's going to be the card they most likely go for. They should be Therapy or Duress to take away your counterbalance to basically buy themselves more turns.
Right.
And otherwise, they'll be coming after your Force of Wills probably to try and finish comboing off like on that same turn. But it'll be one of the two. With Infect, you have to be fast, because unlike Miracles, you can't hide a Force of Will on the top of your deck. All your counterspells have to be in your hand, and most of your counterspells, all of your counterspells other than the Forces, are soft permission. So if the game goes to like turn 4 or 5, they're going to get to the point probably where they can start paying their way through a Daze and through a Spell Pierce or things like that. So the most important thing is land a creature. Glistener Elf is the key here. They have no blockers, so it's the best of all of your creatures. And then you want, I would suggest aggressively using your cantrips to try and find the rest of the combo. If you have to space it out over two turns, like, you know, hit them with Invigorate one turn and then vines them the next turn or something, like if that's how the mana works out, you can do the trick where you like hide the vines on top of your library. But otherwise, this is kind of a race, and they're better at disrupting you than you are at disrupting them. So the real pressure's on you to win the race. You have to go faster.
Yep, certainly agree with that.
All right, so let's go to scenario 6. Our opponent has Mulligan to 6. They lead on a Scalding Tarn, fetch a basic island, and then cast a Preordain. They leave one card on top with the Preordain and put the other on bottom, then draw and pass the turn. What do we think this is?
For me, it's two decks. It's either a show and tell deck. Generally, I tend to think, even though Storm does tend to play Preordain, Scalding Tarn for Island on turn one is not really what they're looking for. They're really looking for like an underground sea more than they are an island. Although, you know, if they do storm me out, I wouldn't be like too surprised. But either way, no matter what, I think my opponent is playing a combo deck.
Yes.
So the two decks for me are Show and Tell. Sneak and Show is a possibility, but Omni Show people also play sometimes, but I'm more likely to think it's a deck like Sneak and Show. But the other deck, and this one's kind of a little off the wall, is I actually think there's also a chance that it might be something like High Tide, which even though it's kind of an underplayed deck, they do have Preordain in the deck. They just have a bunch of draw spells and then, you know, combo pieces, because that's all their deck is. It's just High Tide and Time Spirals and Preordains and Brainstorms. And they do tend to play some number of fetch lands to make their Brainstorms a lot better. So I think it's either one of those decks. Either way, my guess is it's a combo deck. Cards that I'm going to want, you know, just kind of like in the Storm scenario, it's going to be very similar. Going to want cards like Thoughtseize, going to want him to Torok, going to want Force of Will, and going to want something like Tarmogoyf. Either way, you need a quick clock, and you need some form of disruption. And a lot of times, Thoughtseize and him to Torok might not be enough, especially in either of these matchups. So sometimes you're going to want a Force of Will, too, on top of that.
Right, yeah. And actually, I agree, I think this is most likely a show-and-tell strategy, whether it be Omni-Tell or Sneak and Show. And you're completely right. Like a Thoughtseize or a Hymn to Torak is one, especially if it's just one of them, will definitely not be enough, because they're a two card combo, and that means as long as there's two cards in their hand, you could be like seconds away from dying. So you definitely want some more to back it up, like a Force of Will or another hand disruption spell, or even something like a Liliana of the Veil, like something you can start really pressuring their hand long term, backed up by the Tarmogoyf. On Death and Taxes side, if this is show and tell, you can finally pump your fist, because you basically just got an unlosable matchup. You slam Caracas and the game is almost over. After that, you just need a Phyrexian Revoker and the game is literally over. If it's Omni-Tell, it could be a little worse. They could still potentially get you. But even there, you've got some solutions and things like Flicker Wisp and through your Aether Vial and stuff. But really, the key here is get your Caracas, get a Thalia to start applying pressure, and then Revoker on the sneak attack, or, you know, once you know for certain what they are, you can use your Revoker judiciously. But this is almost certainly a good matchup, barring a really fast kill from any of the decks we described.
Right.
How about Miracles?
For Miracles, you're gonna want. I mean, it's kind of like the same thing in almost every matchup. You just really want a counterbalance, especially decks that are filled with ones and twos. That's where counterbalance is really gonna shine. And a lot of these combo decks, you know, they're really reliant on a lot of their draw spells. And the reason is because it has a ton of consistency to their decks. Mm-hmm. And so in order to keep their consistency going, you'll see a lot of these combo decks. They'll play 4 Brainstorm, 4 Ponder, 4 Gitaxian Probe, and 2-4 Preordained. So you just have so much draw in their deck that, you know, it's good too because they need it to be consistent. So counterbalance specifically is going to kind of shut that down. What I'm also going to want is like a counter spell or a force of will to kind of keep the pressure, to kind of keep answers up. But I'm also going to want to try to find some form of pressure. Snapcaster is actually going to be surprisingly good here. Just Snapcaster flashing back a Brainstorm at a turn and then attacking them for 2 while you're using counterbalance to kind of shut them off of everything is going to be, you know, kind of important. It's going to be a good way for you to find a good clean way to attack them to death while you're countering all their cantrips.
Yeah, I agree. I think the most important things is to make all of your land drops for like the first 4 or 5 turns, because they play soft permission, which Miracles doesn't usually have. So you want to get to the point where you're ahead enough on mana that when you get into this counter fight that's almost certainly going to come, that you have the spare resources to pay for their soft magic or counter magic. And then you definitely want to have a force of will of your own, because they will almost certainly at some point fight you over a counterbalance, or they'll try and jam their show and tell in, you know, before your counterbalance is out there, and you want to be ready to fight. Like, you have to have a Vendilion Click or force of will, something to really mess with their plan, or they could get you before you get set up. But and then for Infect, this is sort of an iffy matchup. It really depends on the contents of their hand, because you can apply pressure pretty consistently. Like, there's enough creatures in your deck and you can get them out there. It's just the earlier turns you don't necessarily want to tap out. So depending on the contents of your hand and theirs, you could either just play a land and do nothing, or you could like jam out that Glistener Elf and back it up with like a Daze and a Force of Will. Like, either one of those scenarios gives you good opportunity to squeak through and kill them before they can really set up or, you know, get their combo going. It just depends on the contents of your hand. And another really important point, as this game progresses, if they sit there and spin their wheels cantripping a lot, looking for their combo pieces, what I would suggest doing is, if you have your combo pieces, like say you have an Invigorate and you have a Become Immense, like don't try and beat them at the counterspell game. Just jam your spells right into their counters, because they're going to die if they don't use them, and you can let your spells get countered to eat up all their counter magic, so that when they finally go for their show and tell, you're the only one with counter magic left. And because your threats come down for 1 mana and theirs have to come down via show and tell, it gives you a leg up in that regard. So I actually think ignore whether they have counter spells or not, and just go for kills as soon as you have it, so that you're fighting counter wars on your terms instead of on theirs.
Yeah, I agree with that.
All right, so moving on, we got scenario 7. Our opponent has Mulligan to 6. They lead off with an Ancient Tomb into a Chalice of the Void, X equals 1. Now, this is one of the few scenarios where being on the play versus the draw will make a huge difference. Let's start off by saying we're on the play, and we'll look at Shardless. Well, first of all, what is this most likely, and then analyze it for Shardless.
So I'm going to have to go ahead and just say this is Eldrazi. I think there are a couple other decks that play Chalice of the Void, stuff like Blue-Black Tezzeret is a deck that's likely to play a turn 1 Chalice. Something like Mud, very similar, can also play it. There's also some weird fringe decks like Splinter Twin that sometimes play Chalice of the Void and Ancient Tomb. But most likely, I'm going to say this is Eldrazi. Eldrazi has been incredibly popular lately. And you can't really blame people. When the deck got banned in Modern, people just owned all of these Eldrazi cards. And then all they needed to do was buy some Ancient Tomb, City of Traders, and some Wastelands, and then pick up their deck and move it into Legacy.
And it's surprisingly good.
Right.
They already have the pieces, and it's a strong deck, so it's very enticing, like you said, just move into it.
Right. So I'm just going to assume that they're playing some sort of Eldrazi deck. So important cards for Shardless in this matchup, whether you're on the play, whether you're on the draw, they're going to kind of ring the same way. Liliana is going to be really good here, trying to keep control of their creatures. Abrupt Decay is going to be very mediocre, but it's going to be good at killing Chalice of the Void for you to free up all of your Brainstorms. It's also good at getting Mimic. Mimic is one of the good ways they can kind of get out from underneath you. And then the other card I'm really looking for is, after I decay Chalice of the Void, is Tarmogoyf, since Tarmogoyf is going to be really good at both blocking and attacking here. And this is a matchup where you're probably going to spend a lot of time blocking. Reality Smasher is a 5-5, hard for you to kind of attack through, or kind of hard for you to attack when they just have this hasty 5-5 threat. And especially since they're coming out of the gates so quickly with a lot of this, you know, kind of fast mana, you're going to kind of want to play it safe.
I agree. Now, if with Chardless, you have a lot more wiggle room against the turn one Chalice, especially if you're on the draw. So you wouldn't, I wouldn't think you'd be as concerned about Force of Willingness. I mean, obviously the contents of your hand would make a difference, you know, would tell you, like, if
right.
your hand has Brainstorm and Deathrite Shaman, I think you have to try and force it if you can.
For sure.
But if you don't, like, say your hand has Tarmogoyf, Abrupt Decay, and like you said, like a Liliana of the Veil that you just have to wait a turn or two, I could see making an argument for just let the Chalice resolve, hold your Force of Will for the turn two Thought Knotseer or something like that instead.
Right. And hope they just don't have Cavern of Souls.
Yeah. Well, yeah, there's that. I mean, if they have it all, they have it all. But if, assuming they go like turn two Eldrazi Temple and then try and slam a Thought Knot, I would much rather have the Force of Will for the Thought Knotseer than
right.
the Chalice on turn one here. If we are so lucky.
I think you're more likely to want to force a Reality Smasher
or
something like an Endbringer, but they're both pretty close.
Yeah, well, and the issue with Thought Knot is if you don't force it, they'll probably take your force. So
right.
You either get it or you're not going to get a chance to. But in any event, I agree with you. Tarmogoyf is a wall for most of this game. He blocks all their dudes and protects your Planeswalkers, which is how you're actually going to win the game.
I'm also going to want Baleful Strix. Baleful Strix has kind of been mediocre in a ton of these matchups. It's going to be really good in this matchup. It's going to allow us to, you know, kind of cycle through. So, you know, we're never down a card when we cast it. And then it's going to block and trade with every single creature that they have.
Baleful Strix is a house against big fat creatures.
Don't draw Warping Whale. Don't draw Warping Whale. Don't draw Warping Whale.
And even then, like, that stinks, but it's still like a one, or a, whatever it is, a 1-0 or whatever, right? Like, they have to burn
right.
a card and you're still up. So it's
right. You still have
it,
the
it
same amount.
Yeah.
I agree.
From Death and Taxes' point of view, if we were on the play, this Chalice probably doesn't matter because we either played our Mother of Runes or our Aether Vial on turn one. So we're set there. If we're on the draw, the contents of our hand mean a lot here. Like, if we have the ability to get like a turn two Stoneforge Mystic into like a Batterskull, we could be safe. Or something like a turn two Thalia into a turn three like Flickerwisp to get rid of the Chalice and sort of reset this whole board. Or like, say they play an Endless one, then your Flickerwisp has a lot more value. So it somewhat depends on whether we're on the play or the draw. Unfortunately, we don't have a lot of control over that. But the most important things are getting the equipment. And either one of the equipment's really solid here. Like I said, I think in general, Batterskull is probably a little better, but Jitte is really strong too. And then you want usually an evasive threat to go with it. You're going to want a Flickerwisp or a Sarah Avenger, something to suit up with your Jitte or whatever, and start clocking them back, because you can fight them early with some of your stuff, but long term you have to put pressure on them, because like eventually they get the big guns, like the Endless ones will get too big to deal with, and some of them run whatever he's called, Endbringer or something like that. It is eventually going to ruin you if you wait long enough. So you have to have a mix of things to do, and hopefully it involves equipment.
Right.
How about Miracles?
If I'm playing Miracles, this is a turn one Chalice on the play is going to be so devastating. Ponder, Brainstorm, and Sensei's Divining Top and Swords to Plowshares are just cold for the rest of the match, or for the rest of that game, and that's going to be so devastating, because you kind of need those to add some consistency or make sure you can find a Terminus or even use a Terminus on their turn. So that's going to be really devastating. other cards that I'm if I'm on the play, I'm hoping that I really played a turn one Sensei's Divining Top, or if I didn't, I found a Force of Will, because you're going to have to Force Will this. You can play without it, but it's going to be really difficult for you to win the game. After that, you're looking for a Jace and an early Entreat the Angels to create a bunch of blockers and maybe kill your opponent. Unfortunately, Eldrazi does a ton of damage to themselves with Ancient Tomb and Dismember, so there's a good chance that... that you could just win the game with a small Entreat.
Yeah, I think in this matchup, Miracles is definitely an underdog, and if you're on the draw and this happens, your game could actually be over with this Chalice, like, right now if you don't have a Force of Will for it. But like you said, the most important things are going to be to get an early top, as always, and probably not draw any, like, ever use it to draw a card unless the card you're drawing is Entreat the Angels. Because otherwise, there's always the chance that they can get a Chalice after you've drawn with it, and then it basically shuts your top off from that point on because you can't recast it. But I agree that the Entreat is probably one of the most important cards, and Swords to Plowshares. Those two will be the things that will carry you, hopefully, late enough into the game.
Right.
If you're on Infect, this can vary wildly whether this matters or not. If you look at your opener and it's like a Blighted Agent or an Ink Moth Nexus along with some of the other combo pieces, and you have a Force of Will, you can completely disregard this because you may actually just be able to kill them without ever having to cast a one mana spell. That said, if your hand is like Noble Hierarch, Brainstorm, and like a Berserker, or you know, whatever, some other yeah. bad combos, then this is terrible and you absolutely have to stop it. You could be shut out immediately. Some versions of Infect will play ways around this, like Green Sun Zenith or something like that. You can go get a one mana creature. But yeah, it really depends on what your hand is like, and also if you're on the play or the draw here. Because on the play, you may already have a Glistener Elf, and like I said, if the rest of your hand is something like a Green Sun Zenith and Invigorates or whatever, who cares? Just let it resolve and go for your combo kill as soon as you're ready to do it, because you actually avoid playing a lot of one mana spells despite being a super low to the ground tempo deck. That it really depends on the contents of your hand. For all of our decks, this is other than Shardless, this can be a swingy matchup depending on the contents of your hand and whether you're on the play or draw, and as most Chalice decks are.
Right.
I think Shardless is favored in this pretty heavily, especially if you're on the play. If you're on the draw, it could be closer to 50-50, but even so, the Chalice is just not near as devastating against
especially when you're playing a main deck, you know, Abrupt Decays and potentially a Maelstrom Pulse. Chalice is just, like, so mediocre.
Actually, it's worth noting here, or I'll mention this, at Star City Philly, the last Legacy Open, I was anticipating this deck to be popular. We're assuming this is the Eldrazi deck. And I actually played the Green Sun package with a main deck Viridian Corruptor because I was so worried about how bad Chalice and main deck Jitae might be for me that I wanted to have like the main deck answered so I couldn't just get shut out in case I got paired against it, you know, like five rounds in a row. And that's when I learned that I had overreacted. I didn't need that Corruptor because like I said, there's a lot of non-one mana spells that you can still cast and get around it. And especially because of Ink Moth Nexus, like you can deploy a creature on time whenever you want, like, you know, without missing a beat because of this, that, like, it's really not as big a deal as I thought it would be. But I was ready for it anyway.
Right.
All right, let's go to scenario 8. Our opponent hasn't mulliganed, and their opening play is Mana Confluence. For those of you who don't know, that's a land from Theros block, I think, that taps to add one mana of any color to your mana pool, and you pay a life to do that. So you lose a life, and they get a mana of any color. So anyway, they play that, they get a blue mana, they cast Careful Study, and we'll assume it hasn't resolved yet, because this is a pretty, like, you'll know exactly what it is once it resolves. So let's say it hasn't resolved yet, and you're debating, do I Force a Will this, or don't I? So, and for Death and Taxes, obviously we won't have a choice, but for the rest of them, let's assume that you have a choice. Rudy, go. What is this?
So it's probably like a 95% to be Dredge. I think there are some other decks that play both of those cards. It might be somebody playing Reanimator, but they just can't afford the second Underground Sea, so they just play a Mana Confluence instead for some reason. It's almost entirely going to be Dredge. And I think the Force Will here is actually a really interesting discussion. And I think you could almost write an article, based on like whether or not you should Force Will this careful study. And just there's so many scenarios where you Force Will this careful study and they're like, all right, Lion's Eye Diamond, crack Lion's Eye Diamond for 3 red, Faithless Looting, Dredge, a million, trigger these Dark Amoebas, and then you're just in a ton of trouble. And then there are situations where you force it, and they're like, all right, go. And then they untap, and they're like, all right, Faithless Looting this time. And, they can kind of just go ahead. I think it's really hard what to do, and I think it really depends on the strength of your opponent's hand and how well you can gauge your opponent. If your opponent tanked for a little while and was like, all right, I'll keep, and they're just like, Mana Confluence, careful study, then, I might consider forcing it. But if they're just like, yep, easy keep, all right, play these, you're just like, yeah, all right, fine, resolves. But either way, it's kind of tough. If you're playing Shardless, Deathrite Shaman, incredibly important, being able to interact with their graveyard. Even though Dredge doesn't care about Deathrite Shaman in the way you think they would, it's still really important to kind of gain you any sort of tempo. And I think the other card here that's super important is actually Abrupt Decay. And it's not because you need to Abrupt Decay your opponent's cards, and it's because you need to Abrupt Decay one of your own creatures to remove all their Bridge from Below's. And I think that's an interesting play that when I first started playing Magic and I was playing Stoneblade, I was just like, oh, man, all right, hopefully my opponent attacks so I can block and get rid of their Bridge for Blows. And it never occurred to me that I could just kill my own creature at any point in time to just remove them. And then somebody informed me of that. I was just like, all right. Oh, in your upkeep after you dredge, or in your draw step after you dredge, bounce my Batter's Skull back to my hand. Remove all your bridges.
I agree. I think this is definitely Dredge, and I think you're 100% right. Deathrite Shaman is probably the most important card for turn one. There's nothing you'd rather have, and it even has more utility than just helping accelerate. I think also it's worth noting that Narc Amoeba goes to the graveyard right before it enters the battlefield.
Right.
So if you're trying to slow your opponent down, and keep them from getting the critical mass of creatures they need to cast a Dredge return. Like, you can't do it forever. Eventually, they're going to dredge more guys.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
But you can eat an Narc Amoeba while its trigger is on the stack in the graveyard, and slow them down a little bit that way, and then maybe go after the Icarids or something later.
Yep, Icarids also incredibly important. I was actually just about to say that.
Yeah, and then like you said, the trick where you decay your own guy, or if you have to, you Liliana your edict yourself. Just do something to get rid of the bridges, because really you have to buy time. And I feel like game one, Shardless is an underdog bad here. Because
yeah,
you're,
for
you're
sure.
Just too slow, and your hand disruption's terrible. Like
yes.
Him to Torox is actually awful.
Yeah, post-board, when you have cards like Nile Spellbomb, you're just in a much better shape.
I agree. So we'll hit on Death and Taxes quick. Game one, if they're opening up on this, you've probably already lost. Your best hope is, once again, to get an early Stoneforge Mystic and find a Jitte, because Jitte is the removal spell that can kill your own creatures, like kill your own Mother Runes if you have to, or your Thalia, to get rid of their bridges. And then it's also the way for you to gain life and continue fighting this like onslaught of zombies that they're probably going to have. Like, you're in for a very long game if you don't die quickly, because it's just going to take you an eternity to whittle down all their stuff. Actually, you're probably just as likely to deck them as you are to actually kill them. But you have to get, I think that the absolute pivotal piece here is to get a Stoneforge Mystic in the first couple turns. Probably an Aether Vial too, just because they get free mana and you need some to try and keep up. You're going to have to hope they have bad dredges and you can like help,
yeah.
This is an ugly spot. If you're on the play, it's a little better because you might already have the Aether Vial down, so you can start doing stuff before they get to go dredge crazy. But game one, this is gonna be rough. And I mean, that's what dredge does. It tries to make your game one stink.
Dredge is just such a good game one deck because so many decks just falter to it.
Right. How about miracles?
If I'm playing Miracles, Terminus is going to be incredibly important here as a Sensei's Divining Top. I mean, as we kind of went over before, Top is just such an important, you know, aspect that it's kind of this glue that holds the deck together. And so you're going to want to be able to float Terminus, potentially Force of Will. Some of the Dredge decks are combo versions, but you'll kind of be able to figure that out as you go along. If you see Dread Return, there's a good chance that they also have like Flamekin Zealot or Gristlebrand, you know, in their deck, and they're going to try to combo kill you as fast as possible. But there's also decks that, even though it's not, you know, the words I would use to describe it, you know, you can kind of colloquially refer to it as a slow dredge deck, where you're kind of just kind of grinding your opponent out and using Narcomoeba, Cabal Therapy, Icarus, you know, use your Bridge from Lows, get a bunch of zombies, you know, attack for a bunch every turn, you know, strip their hand. Mm-hmm. So either way, you're going to want to kind of use this top to kind of float Terminus, float a Force of Will, and then counterbalance is not really great here. It doesn't really do too much because they're just doing a lot of things in their graveyard. So those cards are going to be really good here. Snapcaster Mage is going to be really important because you can flash it in and block. If you're playing Vendilion Click is going to be awesome since it also blocks Narcomoeba. And since it trades with pretty much everything, you can knock out all their bridges. And if they're playing the slow dredge deck, it's going to be a lot easier for you to win after that. Swords to Plowshares is going to be incredibly important since Swords exiles and doesn't actually kill anything. It doesn't trigger bridges, and it's a good way for you to get rid of Icarids and Narcomoebas before they're able to utilize any of their graveyard strategy shenanigans.
Especially noteworthy is using the plows because all of their creatures are going to enter the battlefield either on their draw step or their upkeep. That you can instant speed, you can Swords to Plowshares the Icarid before they ever get a chance to like flashback, say a Cabal Therapy or something you couldn't respond
to. Right.
And then with Infect, this is purely a race. They have virtually no disruption, and what little disruption they do have, your Force of Wills or your Dazes are solid against, because like they have no spare mana to pay for a Daze, so it's basically a hard time. And you're going to want either one of your evasive threats and a fast combo kill. Like they're a fast combo deck, you're a fast combo deck, hopefully. And game one, all you can hope for is to get either a Blighted Agent or an Ink Moth down and push the combo kill as fast as you can. Hold back on your Force of Wills for a Dread Return if you can. If I was on Infect, I would probably not counter this Careful Study, just because you don't have to worry about them getting the Dredge Train going. What you have to really worry about is them getting a Dread Return flashed back. So it's a little different than like a Shardless deck where you really want to catch up on tempo because you have to play a long game. Infect can play a very short game, and you may be able to leverage your counter spells to make your short game better than theirs. So, for what that's worth. And finally, scenario 9. Our opponent has mulliganed to 6. They decided to keep it. So they lead out on a Flooded Strand. They fetch an Underground Sea and then cast a Deathrite Shaman. Rudy?
All right, so first things running through my mind, it's either one or two decks. My opponent's either playing the Delver deck with Deathrite Shaman. Delver decks are going to include Sultai Delver, also going to include Grixis Delver in this strategy. They played a blue fetch land, really important here to kind of denote that this is a Delver strategy, and you can pretty much use any blue fetch land to get all of your lands. So it's probably a Delver deck, but a lot of people I know do like to play decks like Deathblade. So Flooded Strand is kind of a, you know, this tell here that it could be one of these two decks. It could be a Delver deck because they can use any blue fetch land. Flooded Strand just happens to count as that. And the other deck it could be is a Stoneblade deck where they need to use Flooded Strand because they sometimes have cards like Plains in their deck, or, you know, so they kind of just need this blue-white fetch land that fetches all their duels because it fetches Tundra, it fetches Scrubland, it fetches Underground Sea. It also is important because it fetches the one of Tropical Island as well. So that's kind of important. So those are the two decks that I'm thinking of.
Yeah, I think I agree. If this is a Delver deck, I think it's almost certainly Grixis Delver, because I can't say it's almost certainly, but it's very likely to be Grixis Delver. If this was Sultai Delver, there are versions that run like all the blues, the blue dual lands, but almost all of them run like one of Bayou. Or they'll try to, just because it makes your sideboard options better. Like if you can bring in double black spells, like whatever the one is that gives -1/-1. And
Marsh Casualties or Liliana the Veil.
Yeah. So, like I said, if it's a Delver deck, it's probably Grixis. And if it's one of the Deathblade variants, then this is a classic opener for Deathblade. I think it's definitely one of those two decks most likely. And anyway, what is Shardless going to do here?
If I'm Shardless, I'm certainly looking for an Abrupt Decay. Abrupt Decay is going to be really important at destroying a Stoneforge Mystic or getting rid of an Uezawa's Jitte. And then the next card I'm looking for is Liliana the Veil. Liliana the Veil is going to be really good since you're both playing a mid-range deck, and since you have Ancestral Vision in your deck, you're more likely to play catch-up than they are. But Liliana the Veil is also important because Deathblade doesn't play a lot of creatures, so it's really easy to manage what they have. But there is one card that you can't really manage, and that's True Name Nemesis. And Liliana the Veil is your only real way, besides something like Toxic Deluge or Pernicious Deed, to really interact with True Name Nemesis. So I really want a Liliana the Veil that can take over the field in an Abrupt Decay. As far as threats, Deathrite Shaman is going to be really good. They don't really have too many ways to interact with it besides Source of Plowshares, and you can kind of eat away at everything they have.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think the Deathrite is also good because they've led out on one. So if it's Deathblade, you want to match their mana production just so that they can't get you from that angle. Like, you would like to be on par with how much mana you each have.
Right.
And if it's a Delver deck, I completely agree. Abrupt Decay is great because they're probably going to be playing either a Delver of Secrets in the next turn or two and trying to set it up with a Brainstorm or something like that, or they'll play like a Young Pyromancer, which is going to be problematic because if they play a Pyromancer, they're almost certainly going to get a token or two with it, but you have to get rid of it that very next turn, because if you let them untap after only getting like one or two tokens to go for more, they'll have like eight tokens, you know, like you just can't stop them then. So the decay, I think, and the fact that it's uncounterable is huge here, or would be very important.
Yep.
From Death and Taxes side, if this is Grixis Delver, it's fine. If you were on the play, hopefully you let out on a Mother of Runes, because they're in a world of hurt then. If you're on the draw, I would still probably lead out on Mother of Runes and just hope that they can't stop it. Like, if they don't have the days, they're going to have a Lightning Bolt. Like, Mother of Runes is just brutal against Delver decks. If it's a Stoneblade deck, then you really want your Aether Vial. Because what you need to do is get ahead of the mana they have from Deathrite. Like, their spells are a little bigger than yours, but you are the mana denial deck, so you have to first get ahead of them on your Aether Vial, something like get a Thalia and a Phyrexian Revoker down to shut off a lot of their mana, and then start pressuring their mana base with Wastelands and Shadenfort and stuff like that. So it without knowing which deck we're against, it actually changes. You don't know which card you want, but I guess in general I would err towards Aether Vial, but
Aether Vial is going to be good at managing the board either way, one way or the other. I think this is important. Something that we kind of have alluded to, but we didn't really actually come out and say, is for the most part, with the exception of Infect, a lot of these cards, a lot of these decks that we play just kind of have good blanket answers, like Swords to Plowshares, or just good blanket cards like Stoneforge Mystic or Tarmogoy for Deathrite Shaman. Just these cards that are just good in general against almost every deck. So you're kind of looking for these cards just in general against a lot of different of all these fair decks, of at least.
Yeah, and that's actually, I should have said that. Having a Plow here, if you're on Death and Taxes, it doesn't matter if this is Deathblade or if this is a Delver deck. If you have the Plow and think you can go for that, like if that's your only line, I would Plow the Deathrite. Because it just puts you back to mana parity, and the longer this game goes, the more favored you get, probably. So just, take away their mana if you can.
Deathrite Shaman's great because it doesn't need to use the combat step. And, if you're playing against a bunch of control decks or, mid-range decks that can clog up the board, like Death and Taxes is pretty famous for, is just putting a bunch of, creatures onto the board that, all have these secondary abilities, that Deathrite Shaman's pretty good at managing that since it doesn't never needs to attack.
What about Miracles?
If I'm playing Miracles, either way, of course, I'm looking for Swords to Plowshares early. Deathrite Shaman is pretty devastating, since it can eat away at whatever your Snapcaster could target and drain you for a ton of life. And in fact, whether they're playing Stoneblade or if they're playing Delver, Deathrite Shaman is just so good against Terminus and Source of Plowshares, since it just requires you to answer it. So it allows them to kind of stock up and play this game where they're like, all right, well, I'm going to play these two threats. And since these threats are just so good on their own, especially Deathrite Shaman, you have to find an answer. And then I can just rebuild. So either way, Swords of Plowshares early is going to be good, as is Terminus. But what's also going to be really good in this kind of scenario is Jace the Mind Sculptor is going to be really good against both of these decks, because your goal against both of these decks is to play cleanup and then play Jace. And that's just a good way for you to kind of shut them down and cold them out of really rebuilding, since you just have Jace and gain a ton of value off it.
Yeah, I agree. The early Deathrite, you need to plow with Miracles. The Deathrite that shows up on turn 4, you can be much more judicious with your removal. Like, if that's going to be their only threat, especially if this is the Delver deck, if that's going to be their only threat for like a few turns, you can probably ignore it if it's like turn 4 or later, because you'll find a better way of dealing with it. Like, you'll find a Jace, or you'll find like a Vendilion Click to race it or something like that. But on turn 1, if you have the plow, you almost have to try and get rid of it, because they will push velocity so hard. They'll play like 2 or 3 spells next turn and try and get way ahead of you that you might not ever be able to catch up if you don't plow it,
right. Or
at least have some good interaction.
Yeah, or even if they come up and they're like Young Pyromancer, play a bunch of spells, and you just don't have Terminus in a couple turns, it can just seal the game for you.
Right. And finally, from Infect's perspective, well, it depends. The contents of their hand make a huge difference here. This is like a Deathblade deck, and they don't have a Stoneforge Mystic. Who cares how many Deathrite Shamans they have? It's too slow, because Infect like will kill real quick. If they do have a Stoneforge Mystic, we could be in a lot of trouble, because Jitte will end our game in a hurry. So really, most times you ignore the Deathrite and look at what comes after it. If it's the Delver deck, like Grixis Delver, this is still the creature we want them to open up on, because it's the one that applies the least amount of pressure and will buy us the most time, or leave us with the most time to get our scenario, our plans set up. But the most important thing here is to have a threat that isn't, or hopefully have a threat that isn't Glistener Elf. Because Deathrite Shaman, if it's not producing mana, and that's what they're going to do, especially if they're the Blade deck, is they're going to sit back on their Deathrite and use him for mana on your turn. They probably won't just like cast spells and spin their wheels, because they want to be able to react to you. So you need a threat that can get around Deathrite Shaman, basically. Because they will throw it in front of him, especially if you don't have like a Noble Hierarch or something to make it an easy pump. Like, if you have to spend a spell, they're gonna block every day. So you want to find an evasive threat, one of the other 8 creatures, and then you're gonna have to be somewhat quick, especially if this is the Grixis Delver deck, because they have really they can produce a fast block. And they will have all the disruption that you don't like to see. They're going to have dazes, they're going to have lightning bolts, and they'll probably have, you know, Spell Pierce or Force of Will to back all that up. So if it's Grixis, you're in a lot of trouble.
And Cabal Therapy, too, which is going to be really good at nailing Umezawa's Jitte or Batterskull after a Stoneforge Mystic.
Right.
Cabal Therapy. They're going to be Cabal Therapy is going to be really good at ripping out any of your Become Immenses or Invigorates or Berserk, anyway, for you to really get far ahead with kill them really quickly.
Right. Yeah. You have to be. You just have to be kind of quick, and that's sort of a truism of Infect. Against a lot of decks, you have to be kind of quick. But decks that can produce extra mana and then like via Deathrite Shaman, but also use it as a blocker, like via Deathrite Shaman, can be a problematic if you don't have like a Blighted Agent to go around it.
Right.
I think I would hold my Force of Wills here, or Force of Will or Daze or whatever spell you have, go after Stoneforge Mystics or go after Young Pyromancers, whichever deck this is, because that will buy you the most amount of time to make use of whatever else you've got. Anyway, that is all of our scenarios for today. So any last thoughts on these decks or others and what we've discussed here today, Rudy?
Yeah, I think it's important to note that even if that assumptions can only get you so far, mm-hmm. but it's best to take some time to, once you're familiar, to kind of approach matchups in a different way. And once you start kind of approaching things like, oh, well, it could be this deck or it could be this deck, what do I really want, will help you actually play a lot better, especially for your next few turns, when you're thinking, okay, well, my opponent led off with, you know, Bloodstained Mire, fetch for an Underground Sea, ponder. So they're probably playing a combo deck. What are some cards that I really want to hit off of, like, my turn one ponder? What are some cards that I really need to look for? Or how should I deploy my threats and in what order? So I think that's kind of important and just like a good lesson to learn. And after playing so much Legacy for so long, this is like a skill that I've gained to kind of identify what people are playing, in the early turns. And it's been really beneficial in a lot of my matchups.
Yeah, definitely. Legacy, more than any other format, I think really favors being able to figure out what your opponent's doing and how you should react quickly, because a lot of times the games take 15 minutes, but they only go for like a total of 10 or 12 turns. So like, or they only matter. I guess miracles can make the game take 25 turns if they want. But really, it's those first 10 turns that decide the outcome of the game. Anyway, I had a lot of fun, Rudy. I think our discussion here was good, and we brought up a lot of interesting points with our analysis and stuff. So I hope everybody was able to follow along with these scenarios. And if there were cards you didn't recognize or decks that we haven't discussed in deck techs yet, Keep watching. I'll eventually cover all of them, and we'll do more episodes like this in the future. I think it's really important, like Rudy said, to be able to identify these kinds of things. So thanks, Rudy, for joining us and helping out.
Yeah, anytime, Zach. Hopefully we'll get to play some Legacy soon, but I'll definitely be seeing you at Columbus, right?
Oh, yeah.
That'll be a lot of fun.
Yeah. All right, and thank you to all of our listeners and viewers. It has been a pleasure to bring you this episode of Legacies of Lore. If you like what you heard today, please subscribe and feel free to leave us feedback on our YouTube page, or you can message me directly at mtgtraininggrounds@gmail.com. Like us on Facebook at the user mtgtraininggrounds, and follow us on Twitter at @mtg_trgrounds. I'm Zachary Cuck. Thank you for joining us.